Hello and welcome to the City of Calgary's webinar on everything you need to know about opening a temporary patio or outdoor cafe in Calgary. Before we get started, I will outline a few features of our webinar. On the top right, there are a few icons. The icon with the question mark is our Q&A. Throughout the webinar, you can post questions here and we will answer as many as we can. The next icon is a cog, where you can change display settings, add subtitles, and change language settings. Subtitles are available for simplified Chinese, Hindi, Filipino, French, Spanish, and Urdu. These settings may not be available on mobile devices. Our webinar is being recorded and will be available to the public at the end of the session. Questions can be submitted anonymously. Now I'd like to introduce our experts. Our presenters are Sheila Geisbrecht, Senior Planning Technician, Rob Leishman, Safety Codes Officer, Andrew Sador, Mobility Initiatives Lead. And joining us in the chat to answer your questions are Melanie Robinson, Senior Planning Technician, Chaz Van Marien, Safety Codes Officer, Bat Erdenbat, Planning Services Technician, and Dana Ellison, Building Safety Codes Officer. My name is Kathleen Smiley, and I'll be hosting today's webinar. Welcome, everyone. First, I'd like to turn it over to Sheila, who will provide an overview on temporary patios and cafes.
Thanks, Kathleen. So patios and patio types. My name's Sheila, by the way, and I've been coordinating the interface between outdoor cafes on private property and seasonal patios on public property for about 10 years. Seasonal patios are seasonal installations on public property, for example, on the road or the sidewalk. They are designed to support restaurants by providing more outdoor seating during the warmer months. If they are on private property or if they are permanent, they go through a different process. And this is going to be covered later in the presentation. An outdoor cafe is an outdoor space where customers can enjoy food and beverages in the open. It's always going to be beside another use that serves food or alcohol like a restaurant. It's never standalone. There are quite a few terms for the same thing. An outdoor cafe is what we call it in the land use bylaw, and that's what it's called when you apply for a development permit. A seasonal patio is a patio on the public sidewalk or the parking lane, and these are always temporary. There are other terms as well: pop-up patio, curbside patio, temporary patio. These are all referred to as the seasonal patios on the public sidewalk or in the boulevard. Now I'm going to turn it over to Andrew, and he's going to go over seasonal patios.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Sheila. So as Sheila stated, the main item with seasonal patios is that they are seasonal. So this occurs during our warmer months. So this year they're going to be running from about the May long weekend, which is about May 15th, until October 9th in 2023. So seasonal patios are something fairly new for the city. And it really came out of COVID-19, where the city allowed businesses to expand onto the roadway and sidewalk as a way of supporting our restaurants in the city. And so prior to 2020, we had about 5 in the city. And then during 2021, we went all the way up to 200. And right now we have about 100 that are set for 2023. And if you can just go on to the next slide, we can talk about the types of patios and who's responsible for what. So this is just an example of one of the seasonal patios in Kensington, where they've gone on to, they've taken over 2 of their parking spots in order to build this patio, which fits about 20 people. They've been very, very positive about it. So for the seasonal patios, the city will approve the location. We produce the guideline document to say what goes where. We issue the permit to the restaurant, and then we install the protective material. Aesthetics have been a big thing for us that we've improved on over time. If you were in the downtown kind of in 2020 and 2021. You remember the orange fencing and ramps, and we've improved on that over time to improve aesthetic, safety, and accessibility. So we have what we deem our bump barriers, which are the painted mural barriers that go on the side of the patio to give protection. We also have a number of planters that go in there. And so what the restaurant is responsible for is everything behind those barriers and planters. So the actual building of the decking for the patio, that's a new requirement. Or it could be a boardwalk. You're going to be the one that initiates it. So you're going to be applying for the permit. We have insurance of $2 million corporate general liability that the city has to be indemnified for. Obtaining a letter from the business improvement area. Most of these are located in the BIAs. So that would be Kensington, Bridgeland, 17th Avenue. We're open to other areas, but it's mostly focused in kind of the inner city BIAs, business improvement areas. And then you're going to be responsible for building and operating that patio. So if you want to go on to the next slide. So looking at the different types, there's basically three main categories that the city allows. So the first is the easiest patio on a partial sidewalk. So this is basically where you have enough pedestrian space to have a chair and table next to the building. So this doesn't really require any protection from the city, so it's quite easy to implement. Next, we have the patio on the curbside or parking lane. So this keeps the sidewalk open, which is really great. And so then the city would come in and install the barrier. Big thing with this is the decking for the patio should be level with the sidewalk, and we need at least 0.5 meters distance from the lane line for traffic safety purposes. And the next one is the patio sidewalk with the pedestrian detour. So in the past, which I'll get to, a lot of these were on the roadways, and we had people going up and down ramps, which was not great for accessibility. So now we've made a requirement that they all have to be level with the sidewalk. We also really work with the businesses and the BIAs to have it so we don't have really short boardwalks, because we don't want pedestrians zigzagging in and out. So if a business is going to do a boardwalk, we want them to work with the other businesses in the area, coordinate through the BIA, and then do a longer stretch. So this is an example of a great boardwalk on First Street Southwest. If we want to flip to the next slide. So this is just going over examples about how the program has evolved over time. So when we first started in 2020, both businesses and the city didn't have a lot of resources or materials to implement. So we were using traffic cones. Businesses were basically just using bits of strings and poles in order to segment off their areas, which was helpful for the businesses. But again, not great for aesthetics, accessibility, or safety. And so if you go to the next slide, you can see what we transitioned to. So working with the BIA, they built this great boardwalk, 2 meters wide, and it really improved the vibrancy of the area. So in this case, the BIA worked with the businesses to install the boardwalk, and the city provided the safety materials at the ends. Next slide. This is another example on 17th Avenue. So not everyone went with the boardwalks on 17th. So this is a great example from a great restaurant, Comrie Block, where they had patios on the sidewalk. We had a pedestrian detour. And if you go to the next one, you can see how we've improved. So now the sidewalk is open in the area. The patio is a bit more defined, which is better for the business, way more popular. And so if you go to the next one, this is one of my favorite transformations. First Street, we had pedestrians diverted onto the roadway, which wasn't great for accessibility. And then we transitioned it to this. And by we, I really have to give the kudos to the businesses in the area who built the boardwalk. At the very front of this patio is a curb bulb, so it's protected already, so we didn't need to provide additional protection. But this was a great example from the businesses. I believe 10 Foot Henry led this, and it looks really slick. The businesses, every time I walk by there, were super busy, adds to the vibrancy of the city. So I was a huge fan of this. Now looking at changes for 2023. So unfortunately we did have a incident. No one was hurt at one of the restaurants, Bottle Screw Bills. And so as the city, we want to make these places as safe as possible. So we're putting in a bunch more protection this year, but we still want to make it aesthetically great. So we're using the painted bump barriers, the mural barriers. So the collaboration with the Beltline Urban Mural Project. We're putting in side protection in the form of low profile barriers, which we're doing this really great collaboration with Alberta University of the Arts and having some of their students and graduates do vinyl wraps on the barriers, which I'm super excited to see. And then we're doing bike and scooter parking. So we really don't want the scooters riding up and down the boardwalks. We don't want the scooters parked in the middle of the sidewalk. So having some area where they can be placed to get them out of the way, and also providing bike parking. So if you're sitting on a patio and you want to park your bike, we'll have an area like that. And so those are things that are all provided from the City of Calgary. So what the business is responsible for is the boardwalk and then the patio. Next slide. And so how do you apply? So we've been working closely with the business improvement areas and the businesses over time. But if you haven't heard of this, please send us an email at patios@calgary.ca. We have the guidelines on calgary.ca/patios that will tell you all about the application process and what we need. But kind of the short of it is we need dimension drawings. You need a letter of support from the building owner and the BIA. And then we need insurance documentation. And so if you're looking to do something this year, please get in touch with us as soon as possible. We have a contractor on board to install all that patio infrastructure. And so we're going to be starting that on May 15th. If you don't require patio infrastructure or don't require that protective infrastructure, you can get out a bit earlier. We're aiming for May 1st for that. And then we're going to operate until October 9th. We did it a bit later last year. We went all the way to the 31st, had some really nice weather in the first part of October, not so nice weather towards the middle end of October. And it was a bit of an issue taking everything out. So we're just going a little bit earlier this year. And next slide. And kind of just a final note, collaborate with your BIA, their window, to working with you and us. They've been really great to collaborate with. They know a whole lot about the process. And what we found that works best with the patios is if you have a bunch of restaurants together. And so the BIAs can help with this coordination. So you don't just have one patio in the middle of a busy road, which isn't great for traffic, accessibility, and might not provide the best dining experience. So I think that's it for me. I see that there's some questions in the chat. I will give them some responses, but in the interim, I'd like to hand it back over to Sheila.
Thanks, Andrew. So Andrew covered everything for patios on the public sidewalk or the parking lane. And I'm going to talk about patios on private property where you need a development permit. So the first step when you are considering a patio on private property is to contact calgary.ca/livechat and request a pre-application for your outdoor patio. The pre-application, you'll get a number, and that will be assigned to a senior planning technician like myself. And we'll connect with you within a few days and to talk to you about your site and your ideas for your outdoor cafe. You always need a development permit for a patio on private property. Once the development permit is issued, you would then need to update your business license with the license category outdoor patio. During the development permit review, your drawings are circulated to building regulations and they'll take a look and let us know at development permit stage whether or not you're going to need a building permit once the development permit is issued. Applying for a development permit does not guarantee approval of your patio. A development permit is a public process, so we have to circulate it, notice post it, and this might result in input from the community, which we'll have to consider. If the development permit is approved, it will be advertised in the public notice section of the Calgary Herald and on calgary.ca. And then once it's advertised, there's a 3-week appeal period where anyone who's opposed to the outdoor cafe has the opportunity to file an appeal with the Subdivision and Development Appeal Board. The pre-application is the first step. So if you're thinking about an outdoor cafe and you want to get started, just contact us at calgary.ca/livechat and request a pre-application for an outdoor patio. If you have a space where you think, or where we determine that your patio is going to be partly on private land and partly on public property, then you would need two things. You would need a development permit for the portion that's on private land, and you would also need a temporary permit for the area that's on public land. And if that patio that spans both is going to be longer term than just the seasonal for the summer, then you would need a license of occupation. So we would connect you with real estate and development services for that. So the first start is the pre-app, then the development permit, and then we'll coordinate the rest of the permits for you. You also may need a building permit, and we will take a look at that at development permit stage as well. As far as cost goes, development permit fees and temporary permit fees for patios are waived for all of 2023 by council. So at this point, there are no fees. Next slide, please. When you apply for a development permit, it's a public process, so we have two types of public notices. First of all, you make the application for the development permit. We circulate your plans to building regulations, NMAX, the ward councillor, the community association, and the business improvement area. These parties have 7 days to provide us with comment. So we send it out there, wait 7 days, and within those 7 days, we should get comments back. At the same time, we'll request a notice posting to be placed at the property to notify the public that you've applied for a development permit for an outdoor cafe. The notice posting is posted by a contracted company. When they pick it up, they are going to record whether or not the notice was visible and in good condition. It's always a good idea as the applicant to keep an eye on that notice posting, make sure it doesn't blow over. If it does, please pick it up and make sure it's visible. Don't move it. If it goes missing, let us know and we'll get a new notice posting out there as soon as possible. Once we've circulated and notice posted, then any comments that we receive from the public, we'll have to assess. And at this point, we'll be ready to make a decision on your development permit. So with the public notice and the appeal period, the timeline for a development permit usually adds up to about 6 weeks from start to finish. Now I'm going to turn it over to Rob.
Hi, thanks, Sheila. My name is Rob Leishman. I'm a safety codes officer at the city. And today I'm going to be talking about adding structures to your patio. And primarily when I'm speaking about patios in this part of the presentation, I'm talking about permanent patios that are built on private land. So starting here, if you wanted to install any special equipment like a structure, tent or space heater to even a public patio, they are only allowed on private property, so you wouldn't be able to do that. Tents and structures like pergolas and space heaters will require a building permit once the development permit is released. For patios on public land, only a decking is allowed unless special permission is granted by the city to build removable structures. So that's on a case-by-case basis. The following information now is for public patios, such as those at restaurants, bars, or even at event centers. Any decks higher than 2 feet will require a building permit. Pergolas generally require structural engineering, depending on the loads carried. Any roof structures, whether they are screened in or louvered in, also require engineering from a professional structural engineer. Where a roof is used on a patio, it is considered an extension to the building, and all building code requirements must be met, such as the type of construction, fabric, flame spread ratings, and you know whether sprinklers may or may not be required. Shipping containers are also quite popular. You'll see them on patios. They can be used as a shelter. They actually do require an engineer review under the National Building Code of Canada. And they also require an engineer drawing showing how the structure will be placed on the site to prevent movement and overturning. HVAC drawings may also be required for shipping containers if they are being closed in, maybe they're for a temporary kitchen or maybe for a storage area. Sometimes HVAC will be required. The important thing to remember is that any patios, whether they're on public or private land, cannot restrict the exits leading outside from the building, and also cannot restrict fire department access to the building or to the Siamese connections, the fire suppression system connections on the building. So now back to you, Sheila.
Thanks, Rob. Our next slide is for special events. And I notice in the chat, one of the questions from the public is, do you need a permit for a special event for Stampede? So special events are on private land called a special function, and there's a whole set of rules in the land use bylaw for special functions. So if you're thinking about a special event, you should contact the Planning Services Center to inquire before you plan your event. There's also going to be a webinar in May on everything you need to know about temporary event tents. So go to calgary.ca/webinars and look up the one for special events, sign up for that. Rob, I think it's you next.
Thanks again, Sheila. Now I am going to talk about whether or not you will need professional involvement for your patio. For the building permit, if you are hiring someone to do the work for you, they will need to apply for the permit. Visit our hiring a contractor page to review the 5 steps to choosing a contractor. For professional involvement, an architect or professional engineer may be required to design and inspect your project. Refer to the current National Building Code, Alberta Edition, under Division C, section 2.4.2. In that section, it outlines where professional involvement is required. Typically for restaurants, professional involvement is required when the restaurant square footage is greater than 300 square meters. Now on to patio business licensing. If you already have a business license to operate, you will need to add an outdoor patio license category to operate your patio. To add an outdoor patio license category, please contact Planning Services Center online at calgary.ca/live chat, I think. And back to you, Sheila.
Yeah, that is the right address, Rob. calgary.ca/live chat. So once you have your permit for your outdoor cafe, so that would be either your development permit or your temporary permit issued by mobility for your seasonal patio on the public sidewalk, you need further inspections. You need a health inspector approval. You need a fire inspector approval, an occupant load card issued, and AGLC inspector approval and AGLC license if you're serving alcohol. When you call AGLC, they will look at your business license to make sure that you have the license category outdoor patio on the license. On the City of Calgary business license, outdoor patio is a license category. And then they will also ask you for your occupant load card for the patio, which is issued by the fire inspector. So that's why it goes health inspector first, then fire inspector, and then AGLC inspector. So back to you, Rob.
Thanks again. Yeah, so finally, we're going to talk about booking your inspections. Now, I believe these instructions here are for booking your inspections, more so for a patio that's on public property or at least half on public property. So once you have a development permit and or a road permit for the patio, you will need a fire inspection. Set up the patio first. Make sure to place planters, tables, and chairs so that there is a clear exit path from the interior of the restaurant out through the patio to the exterior. Don't place furniture or planters where they will block the Siamese fire hose connections on the building exterior. Exits must be a minimum of 1.1 meters wide. Then what you're going to want to do is call 311 to request a fire inspection or a special event inspection. Once the inspection is complete, the fire inspector will email AGLC to let them know that you have your occupant load card. Once you are granted your occupant load card and you have been issued your license to serve alcohol by the AGLC, you can start operating your new outdoor patio space.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Rob, and thank you to all of our presenters this afternoon. So that concludes our presentation portion of today's webinar. Now we're going to open it up to some audience questions. So feel free, anyone that is on the webinar, pop your questions into the chat and we will set up for some live Q&A. So I'm just going to go ahead and take a look at what we have so far. All right. So if I'm hosting a special event and only need patio space for a week, do I still need to apply for a permit? Sheila, do you want to take a crack at that one?
Yes, Sheila or Rob? I can answer that question. So for okay. A special event, if you're thinking of a special event, it's good to set up a pre-op. So call calgary.ca or go to calgary.ca/live chat and request a pre-application inquiry. It's a free service, and we'll have an expert talk to you about your event and give you the lowdown about what you need.
Excellent. Thank you for that insight, Sheila. Next question coming up, can the patio have solid walls as opposed to fabric? Any takers? Sheila, Andrew, or Rob?
Yeah, your patio can have solid walls. It depends on the circumstances. Let's say it's a tent structure. If it is a tent structure and it's only going to be there on a temporary basis, like, you know, say even a week or something like that. Typically, we can allow four tents in whatever situation you may have. Now, if you're talking more so a permanent patio, where you want to have some walls and you want them to have permanent, you want this thing to be up the entire season, that's where the building code will really kick in. And basically, you probably the best thing to do at that point is to hire either an architectural technologist or an architect to analyze your situation and determine what building code requirements may or may not affect you. Because there is a bit of a misunderstanding there. People think that, you know, maybe because it's just a pergola, or it's just a pergola with a roof on it, or a trellis frame, that the code doesn't apply to it, but it actually does.
Okay, thank you for that, Rob. Good to know. How do you get a designed barrier? Can we paint them ourselves? Andrew, would you like to take this one?
Yeah, sure. So we have our barriers painted by local artists through the Beltline Urban Mural Program. And so they paint them at our snow dump site, because we don't want them to paint them on the roadway, and then we install them after. If you're looking to paint something, just send me a note, patios@calgary.ca, and we can chat. Definitely not oppose the idea, but that's how we do it. We get local artists to come in, and it's organized by that nonprofit, the Beltline Urban Mural Program. And I think they do a great job. And we're going to be painting about 60 new ones this year. And we have about 20 local artists doing it.
Oh, wow. Love that collaboration for us. Okay, next question's coming up. I'm having an event in November. Do patio permits extend into the winter months? Or are they allowed to be only in the spring and summer? Can I open a patio on public property year-round? Is there a time frame that I'm allowed to operate?
I can take a shot at that. We okay. haven't explored that. I would say it's really context specific. We wouldn't want a patio, like one patio on the middle of 17th Avenue during the winter, which I think would cause maybe some frustration for motorists and might impact our snowplow operations. But if it's on like a small side street, a roadway that doesn't get plowed, if it's not interrupting traffic that much, I think we could explore it. So just again, send us an email to patios@calgary.ca. One of the things that we've learned through this process is just that a lot depends on context. Certain things make sense in certain areas and certain things don't. So happy to explore that with you.
Excellent. Thank you for that insight. Okay. Can the business next to me dispute my application for a patio? Sheila, would you like to provide some more context?
Yes. If it's a patio that's on private property, you would need a development permit, and a development permit decision of approval or refusal can be appealed. So that's why we advertise it and wait 21 days. That 21-day appeal period is for anybody who's opposed to the decision to approve the patio. Might be a business next door to you or a resident behind you. If the 21-day appeal period closes and no appeals have come in, then the DP is released and it can't be disputed. The decision can't be disputed, but anyone can call in a complaint on noise or anything after that, and it would be investigated.
Okay, perfect.
And maybe just to add to if it's on public roadway and you want to do a seasonal patio, this is where the BIA really comes in handy and why we ask that for that letter of support. So we do have it. You can't encroach on the area in front of another business without their permission. But we do ask for that you provide a letter from that business improvement area saying that they're in support of it.
Okay, perfect. Thank you to the both of you. All right, next question in the chat coming up, you guys. Am I allowed to host pets and serve alcohol on my patio? Do I need permission?
Is that more of an AGLC thing?
It's a Alberta Health thing. Okay. So just check with your Alberta Health Inspector.
Okay. Excellent. All right, moving right along here. I want to decorate patio space. Am I allowed to have plants, pergolas, space heaters? I know we touched on this in the presentation, but Rob, do you want to give a little bit of context regarding this one?
Sure. I think, and maybe Andrew, you can speak to the public spaces better than I, since I primarily work in the private spaces, but definitely for any pergola structures that you may be building on your private property, you will require a building permit for that. But yes, you're most definitely allowed to do that in the private setting for sure.
Excellent. And Andrew, do you want to give a little bit of insight in terms of public setting?
Yeah. So for the most part, the stuff coming through our group in mobility isn't putting in structures because we're not reviewing the structures. And so if you're building something, you would likely go through a license of occupation where they would do that review. And the purpose of that is we don't want someone to build a pergola and then a windstorm comes and it falls over on people, right? So it needs that structural review. We're not doing that in mobility. We're basically just providing the space for tables and chairs and plants. And so it would go through that other process.
Yeah. So I think at that point then, Andrew, if they were wanting to put up, say, a pergola, even in a public space, we would look at it as a temporary permit and would probably still do a building permit for that to ensure safety.
Yep.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you to the both of you. All right. So I need help with my application. Who can I contact?
Us. So it depends if it's on if you're doing a seasonal patio, just contact me. I'm the one who monitors the patios at Calgary.ca. And if it's something private, Sheila's the person to go to.
Excellent. Great. Thank you so much. Keep moving right along. Next question in the chat. So what types of permits do I need to open a temporary patio for my business? I know that we covered this during the presentation, but Sheila, if you'd like to touch on this again, that would be great.
So the question is, what types of permits do I need for a temporary patio?
Correct.
Okay, so if it's on private property, development permit, whether or not it's temporary for the summer or long-term, development permit, private property. Public property, temporary permit for a seasonal patio on the public sidewalk, boulevard, parking lane, patios at calgary.ca.
Excellent. Very straightforward. Okay. Moving right along. Can we have live music on the patio? Hopefully this is yes. Rob, Sheila, or Andrew, any takers?
Well, I can answer to that.
Okay.
Live music is not prohibited. However, if your patio is near a residential area, let's say it's in the back parking lot along in Inglewood, 9th Avenue, there are quite a few patios behind the buildings, and then right across the lane is residential. In that case, we may condition your permit to allow for music during certain times of day. But normally we don't get into music on patios. The land use bylaw doesn't address that. And so it would be the noise bylaw that you would just have to adhere to the noise bylaw rules.
Okay, perfect. Thank you for that insight. All right, everyone listening, we have about 5 minutes left. So if you have any burning questions, please put them in the chat so we can get them answered before we close out today's webinar. Does the city give, sorry, does the, do I, did I understand correctly? Does the city get, sorry, everyone, that one just got published. Let me see if I can go find this again. Did I understand correctly? The city gives barriers for the road patio. Is it free?
Yep, 100% free. So we're in charge of the traffic protection. So you install your boardwalk or patio, and then we come in after with the barriers to protect. So this is the large planters, the barriers, and we put them in for safety, but we also want to make them look good. There's a lot of examples from even our city of barriers that don't look good, don't add to the restaurant or vibrancy of the city. And so we collaborate with groups like Bump, we do planters in order to create a good vibe and also to protect those patios. So that is covered by the city.
Excellent. Love to hear that. All right. Moving on to the next question, can we prepare food on a patio? I want to run beer taps out to it and pour from a station.
I know that I have definitely issued building permits for patios on private property where they are definitely doing that. Again, Andrew, I'm not sure if it changes anything on public lands.
I'm just looking at our guidelines here, and it says cooking or preparing food on the patios, on the seasonal patios is not permitted. I think if you have a question or maybe it's something specific, feel free to contact us. So if maybe it's like, hey, can we prepare this guacamole dish or something?
Can I jump in there, Andrew?
Sure.
I think the best thing to do as well is talk to your health inspector, because there's a thing about access to potable water. So I think health inspection first.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's the reason why that it's done is for the health and safety aspect. So I would connect with them.
Yeah, and that's true. The patios that I've done where they are doing some food preparation out on them, you're absolutely right. They've made provisions for having potable water. And I've even seen some instances where they've gone so far as to bring in like a water cistern, just so they're able to access that potable water within their space.
Excellent. Thank you to the three of you for answering that question. All right, we got about 2 minutes left, so we'll see if we can get to these last couple questions. Is there a max area for private patios?
No maximum area. We're basically looking at the site and what's best for your business and your site. So if it's a giant site and you want to have a really large outdoor cafe, then we can certainly consider it.
Perfect. All right, and our last question, I'm pretty sure that this is an easy one. Can I come into the city hall to apply?
Yes, you can. but it would be good to have a pre-app first.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for participating in the city's webinar on opening a temporary patio this afternoon. I have posted a slide with our phone number and website for more information. If you have questions, you can contact us by phone at 403-268-5311. You can visit us on the third floor of the municipal building or chat with us online. A link to this recording will be available on calgary.ca/webinars. You can also rewatch this webinar by clicking the same link provided in your Eventbrite ticket. I'm also going to share the link to our post-event survey in the chat. Please take a few minutes to let us know how we did this afternoon and any other topics you would like to know more about. Thank you all and have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.